My name is Kitia Altman, and I was born in Poland in a small town. Name of the town was Bedzin, known in German as Ravensbruck. I matriculated in 1939, which is equivalent to finishing the high school. And we were practically under the Germans 6 hours after they entered Poland. I say about myself that I am, in a way, a typical, but in many other way, not a typical survivor. I am typical in as much that I lived through the Holocaust. I was in labor camps, in concentration camps, in extermination camp, Auschwitz. But the two factors that contributed to my survival first and my healing process later were the fact that throughout the duration of Holocaust in Poland, since 39 to 45, I had a friend, a girlfriend. And we were very, very close together. She was older, she was wiser, and she became my conscience. And through all the phases of living in ghetto, of being in camps, we were very closely bonded together, and we were extremely lucky. The possibility of being separated in Auschwitz through selection, through sickness, through death, was a stuff from which our nightmares were made, even after the war. In times where humanity was practically non-existent, in times where human being was made look grotesque, was degraded, humiliated, and in those times, just calling each other by name and not by number that we both had, the tattoo. The fact that we could talk about our families. We reminded each other about things like sitting on a chair and eating soup with a spoon and not lapping that out of a dirty bowl like a dog with your tongue. So these little incidents had a tremendously, not only they had a humanizing effect on both of us, but they kept us on the edge of total dehumanization. The other factor that helped me in survival was the obvious fact that I came to Auschwitz late. Up till that time, we wore our civilian clothes, we had access to water, to soap, we kept ourselves clean, we had a toothbrush, a comb, a mirror. Some people managed even had to have a bit of a lipstick. We ate sitting at the table. The food was cooked by the cook of the ghetto. Suddenly, we arrived to Auschwitz, trying to block out from our consciousness the fact that such a place exists. We were transported there in cattle wagons. I cannot tell you how long we traveled. The wagons were dark. There was no water and no facilities to relieve yourself. In our case, we were only girls, young girls. There was nowhere to sit down. we were the aim of the transportation under such condition was to demoralize people before they even arrive where they had to arrive. And it must have been a long journey because each one got used already to the sound of the wheels and to the rocking of the train. And as far as I was concerned, all I want was to sleep and to sleep and to sleep. And suddenly I was jerked out of that stupor and the train stopped. And we heard the heavy iron bar to be lifted and the sliding door opened. And we found ourselves on the platform. The force of the people at the back of the wagon pushed us, and we fell out. We spilled, just like a sack of potatoes. And we spilled on a black platform that had a bluish light. And the first thing that hit me was the silence. We were perhaps 1,000 women from different camps. It was a deathly silence. It was not a silence that gives you the feeling of peace, of quietude. It was a silence of death and the bluish light and figures that stood there motionless in stripes. And I remember I had that urge to touch such a figure. I thought they are cutouts. They were thin. They were almost one-dimensional. They didn't throw a shadow. They were thin. So I thought that they are cutouts from some wood. And they were uniforms, uniformed people. And we immediately fell into a group of people who know each other. And I was the one who said, girls, it's all true. Meaning that we are here at the end, that's the end. And I remember I looked up and in places the dark sky had a pinkish glow and I was still thinking like a human being, like a person, because I thought to myself, it's strange, everything here is strange, but the nature works like it works normally. After night comes day, and that is the break of dawn. That was my last formulated thought, and then there was suddenly a scream, a yell, schnell, 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 you know, quick, quick, quick. And we were pushed through the gate, and I stood on the extreme left and about not further than this window, a meter away from me stood a guard with a weapon on his shoulder, and he was whispering loud enough for me to hear, for anybody to hear, in German, and I knew perfectly well German, and he said, Auschwitz, you enter through the gate, and you leave, and he jerked his head up, and I followed that up, and I saw chimneys, chimneys with fire, and what I thought was the break of dawn, was a reflection of fire. We still did not associate that because what I think happened, at least it happened to me, I stopped thinking. And I remember I said to myself, stop thinking and feeling. The feeling was more than thinking, stop feeling. And we ran and ran through two rows of very low huts, and by that time was already grayish, and day, and the real dawn broke, and some shapes were crawling out of these huts, and we couldn't establish whether they are men or women. They all had their hair cut like in the olden days they used to cut the hair in asylum. Everyone who's asylum had those sticky hair cut to make him look grotesque, and they were wrapped with what we later discovered were those so-called blankets. And as I said, there were about 1,000 women, and each one called out in her own language, in all languages, who are you and where are we? We still did not know for sure where we were. And there was no response, no contact. I remember I was running and I got my period. And I said, my God, blood was immediately associated with murder. If they see that I am bleeding. There was not a scrap of paper anywhere. Not a rag where I could wipe myself. Nothing. And I started to cry. And Sasha, my girlfriend, remember, she pulled down her dress and started to wipe my thing. And we were not allowed to stop. We were not allowed to leave our formation. With him, a very brief period, quite deliberately, we were made looking unrecognizable. We couldn't recognize each other. On our naked, wet bodies, we were thrown dresses, and there must have been a method in the madness, because the tall girls got short dresses, the short girls got long dresses, the thick got narrow dresses, and so on. And I remember I was calling my girlfriend, Sasha, Sasha. I couldn't see her anywhere. And suddenly somebody was pulling my hand. I looked at her, I said, who are you? I said, I am Sasha. I looked at her, and I saw how I look. I think that I worked on my experiences, on my memories, and on my feelings about Holocaust and about German people. And I came to a conclusion that it was a manipulated event, manipulated by extremely clever, shrewd, and evil-thinking people. And I thought to myself, if German people, educated, cultured, civilized, could fall victims to such a manipulation, one has to warn people about it. I also felt that it was that they themselves, in a way, were victims of their own regime, a regime that relieves an individual from responsibility for his deeds.